Good morning. Today's assigned lectionary reading addresses the reality of human suffering, the lives lost in battle, the debilitating cost of chronic disease, the death of a child, the cry of despair. God comes to those in pain with healing and grace, restoring life and hope, offering the abundance of steadfast love, bringing peace to troubled souls. This is a vision of living in Shalom, a world of God's peace, where all find healing and peace, and where everyone has enough to thrive. In response to God's amazing gifts, we are called to build that community as we live generous lives, offering from our abundance that others might simply live. Please join in a responsive call to worship. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and did not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord, my God, I cry to you for help. Oh, that's what you just read. And you have healed me. O Lord, you brought me up. You brought up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit. Let us pray. Loving God, we are yours. We come as we are, with our cares and concerns. We long to touch you and find healing in your embrace. Strengthen our faith and heal our brokenness, that we may worship with you with joy. Amen. Our opening hymn of praise is, Holy God, we praise thy name. Please stand if you are able.
Thank you.
Let us confess our sins to God, confident in God's promise to forgive us, heal us, and transform us. Please join in the printed prayer of confession. Holy and loving God, you promise us that you are making all things new. Yet we see the pain and injustice in our world and in our lives, and we do not believe you. Forgive us for our tiny faith. Make us confident in your promises, that we may be people of courageous hope, healers in a world desperate for restoration. Amen. Lamentations 3:22 and verse 23 tells us, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. God loves us no matter what. I declare it to you with confidence in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven. Live in that forgiveness this day and always. Amen."
When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him. While he was by the lake, then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. "Please, come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid. Just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion, with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him, and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately, the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this, and told them to give her something to eat. "You're not Julius Caesar."
One, two, three. Yes. Perfect. Thank you, and sorry about that. I hope you didn't hear what I said. If you didn't, you're going to hear it again. As you can tell, the text is not read because we already listened to it through that video clip that we did share with your beautiful daughters and sons. We come today to a chapter which is full of events, full of miracles, full of great signs that Jesus did on the other side of the lake. We are in front of a woman that has been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years. And she interrupted Jesus' journey, who was in his way to heal this 12 years old daughter of Jairus. Jairus was a member, or actually was a leader. So you can think of him, he wasn't a priest, but he was a leader, like a lay leader, probably like any of you, was an active lay leader in the Jewish synagogue. There are a lot of similarities between Jairus and between this woman that was bleeding for 12 years. And what is the commonality? Is that both of them were very desperate. Very desperate. The woman very desperate to get healing because she spent all of her money. And the doctors were not of any help. In fact, they made her worse. And of course, you know, the heart of a father seeing his 12 years old. And we don't know much. We don't know even her name. We only know his name. We don't also know the name of the other suffering woman. But for sure, we know that they both were very desperate. So they did. Came to Jesus with this wonderful faith that they had. And the story goes on to tell us that both of them were fully and completely healed. They came with desperate request and desperate state, and they received hope. So therefore, the title of the sermon today is audacious hope, audacious faith, bold and daring faith, because as you can know and see in the story, both of them had no other way to go, no other means to use. What I wanted to do today is I wanted to look at the characters, because this is like a scene, first of all, with large crowd, full of people, but we also have people who were engaging with Jesus Christ. I counted at least five categories of people, and sometimes we can belong to any of these five. We have first Jairus, the leader of the synagogue. The Bible tells us that when Jairus saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. And notice the words. He fell at his feet, at Jesus' feet, and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." Notice I kind of underline the word at the point of death. The Greek word eschatology, from the word eschatology, which means when Jesus talks about eschatology or eschatological event, he talks about the end of life, the end of days. And Mark is using almost the same word here. She is in her last minutes. She is in her last hours of life. Do you get what is going on here? Jairus is a Jew, a leader in the Jewish synagogue, falling at Jesus' feet and begging Jesus, not once, not twice, but repeatedly. In all of the gospel stories, there was no synagogue leader ever recognized Jesus as Lord. You have heard me saying a lot about the Pharisees, the scribes, the leaders of the synagogue, how they were always behind Jesus, wanted to trap him wherever he goes. But here we have somebody who recognized Jesus and bowed down and fell on his knees and his feet. The only one that came close was Nicodemus in John chapter 3, except Nicodemus, who was conscious of his status as a leader in the Jewish community, he came to Jesus at night. You go back and read chapter 3 of John. He did not come at daytime. He doesn't want his people to see him that he's going to talk to this stranger called Jesus, because it's very possible that, you know, he may be considered somebody who is denying the Jewish faith, the Jewish tradition. So he came at night. That's Nicodemus. But Jairus, he came while there is a large crowd of people. It was so crowded, and it was daytime, and it was in front of everybody, coming and begging, not just talking to Jesus, would you please come and heal my daughter? No. He was begging, and he fell on his knees. And that is, according to Jewish tradition, you can't do that. You only, number one in the Ten Commandments, what does it say? Only to your God. You have no other gods. You can't worship. You can't bow to any gods but God. And that's amazing. That I tried, I looked at the scripture, and any other synagogue leader that done that? No. It's this Jairus that he came and fell down. He came to Jesus in the middle of the day and in front of a large crowd. And what did he do? He fell at his feet and begged Jesus repeatedly. Yes, you can say it. Desperate moments call for desperate measures. That's exactly what happened here. Therefore, I can see myself in this scene. I can see myself as Jairus. You may see yourself as well. There is always one moment in our lives when desperate moments call for desperate measures. This is what some meant when he entitled Jairus' action as an audacious act of hope. Even when a group of people came telling Jairus the bad news about his daughter's passing, saying to him, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any farther? Can you imagine these words? But Jairus, who was holding on faith, wouldn't hear except what Jesus said. Do not fear, only believe. Do not fear, only believe. It is not over yet. Even if she dies, she shall live. Almost the same words said to Mary and Martha, you may remember. I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even if they die, they shall live. That was Jairus, a person who put down his guard. This is what we learned today. He put down his guard. He didn't care about his status. He just came and put it down there and said, I don't care what the people say. I don't care if I am the leader of the synagogue. I don't care about my position and my status. I wanted to beg Jesus to come and heal my daughter. There is something for all of us to learn here. The second character is a woman with the hemorrhage. As Jesus was going with Jairus, a large crowd followed. They wanted to see the miracle as well. The trip was interrupted by a woman who was suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. Here is another case of desperation. There was no other options for this woman but to seek Jesus' help. Her trouble was not only physical. This is, we need to go deeper in this. Her trouble, I thought, as I read this story, and I heard it from Sunday school teacher all the time, well, a woman with hemorrhage, physical situation. But her trouble and her misery was much, much, much more. It was emotional. It was psychological. It was economic. She was desperate. And if this was not sad and emotionally disturbing enough, she had to live with a sense of shame, as she supposed to be isolated from all other people. Because according to the law and the ordinances, she was unclean. From where did I get this? Leviticus chapter 15, verse 19 to 30. And this chapter is about three paragraphs. The second paragraph talks about a bleeding woman during her natural time of bleeding. But he also talks about a bleeding as a disease. And that is in the third paragraph. He talks about what a woman should do when she is in such situation. Again, I'm reading from Leviticus chapter 15, 19 to 30, and I hope you will have it in front of you. It says, if a woman has a discharge of blood for many days, not at the time of her impurity, or if she has a discharge beyond the time of her impurity, all the days of the discharge she shall continue in uncleanness. As in the days of her impurity, she shall be unclean. Every bed on which she lies during all the days of her discharge shall be treated as the bed of her impurity, and everything on which she sits shall be unclean, as in the uncleanness of her impurity. Whoever touches these things, and this is important, verse 27, whoever touches these things shall be unclean, and shall wash his clothes, and bathe in water, and be unclean until the evening. If she is cleaned of her discharge, she shall count 7 days, and after that she shall be clean. And then he tells how she make an offering, sacrifice, and she then will be completely clean. So, there was no way for this woman to make herself known. You see why she came from the back? And why she said, I'm not going to touch him. I'm just going to touch his clothes. I'm going to touch his robe, his garment. She came from the back and she touched it, not him, but his clothes. Do you know why? Do you know why Mark says, and make sure to emphasize Jesus' words to the woman? So she came, the Bible says, when she discovered that Jesus knew, she came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. Do you see that? What does that mean? Why she says the whole truth? What kind of truth? Well, the truth that we talked about in Leviticus. She came to say, Jesus, I'm sorry. I know that I shouldn't do this. I know I should not be in the crowd. I know I shouldn't touch anybody. Not even you, but I did it because I am so desperate. I am so desperate. And here is the key. She told him the whole truth, that she sinned by touching him, and even by breaking her quarantine time. You know, when I went to Canada the last visit, I supposed to be quarantined. I had to be isolated for 14 days. Well, if I didn't, I would be penalized. That's exactly what her feeling was at the time, because she was, of course, she is just like many, many, many whom Jesus came to deliver. She was imprisoned. She was a slave to the law and the ordinances. Yes, my brother and sister, we have already read Leviticus. Do you understand now what Jesus meant and why Jesus came to fulfill the law? It wasn't that it was short. Jesus fulfilled it in his own body. Jesus nailed the law and the ordinances. These are not my words. These are the literal words of the scripture. He nailed all of these, hundreds of them. Hundreds. There were 10 commandments. But the people, the legacies, the people who are writing the law, they start to put all of these heavy things on God's people. Things that they should do and they should not do. And they were enslaved. In addition to the disease and the ignorance and the pain and the suffering, they are under that guilt. Jesus came to deliver not them from physical pain, but from psychological, emotional, and spiritual pain. Many people ask me, why there is no miracle as it used to be? Why these miracles were in the time of Jesus? Wasn't Jesus still Jesus yesterday, today, and forever? And I tell you, miracles do happen. And the greatest miracle of them all is actually the miracle of peace, the miracle of forgiveness, the miracle of coming back to Christ with humility. Do you think that was easy for this man who's been always in his life a true Jew? Was it easy for Paul, who was perfect and was persecuting the disciples, to come and say, you know what, I'm going to go to this man that I used to persecute, and I'm going to ask him to heal me? It requires humility. It requires humbleness to come to God. It is the greatest miracle of all. An addict or a sinful person come and recognize Jesus as Lord and Savior. That is the greatest miracle. The miracles of the old, when Jesus was doing them, was like the bills in a church in the middle of nowhere, where there is no watch or clock, and we used to do that, and we had bill, and we ring the bell so that the people know that the hour of worship has come. We don't need that anymore. Blessed are those who believe and not see. So we do pray. We have trust in God's wonderful, amazing power. But we also know that the miracle of them all is to return to Christ and to come and to be renewed. And that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus delivered her from her shame, from her sense of guilt, and he took all of that away. So that is compassionate Jesus. In both stories, we see Jesus' power, but also we see his compassion. We see him in his full humanity, but also in his divine being as human. He did not know who touched him. He didn't really know. He looked around, who touched me? And when the disciples start to make joke and say, you know, the crowd is everywhere, and you say, who touched me? He kept looking again. We see him as human here. You know, one time Jesus said, that explained to you when one time Jesus said about the end of days, and he said, even the Son of Man doesn't know the hour. And he was talking truthfully. As a human being, he didn't know. But as a divine being, and that's why we always say that, Jesus was fully human, was also fully divine. As a divine being, Jesus had the power to heal and to raise from the dead. And when Jesus did this, he did not ask for publicity. He didn't care. You know, it was probably better for him. And you know what? It's probably why the disciples were feeling disappointed. Come on, Jesus. Come on. Keep moving. Keep moving. You know that there is a large crowd. We have a famous person there. His name is Jairus, his daughter. And we need to go and do this miracle so that the world can see. Very famous thing going to happen to a very famous person. The publicity will be great. But Jesus stopped and looked at the woman and didn't care about the time, didn't care about publicity. And he attended to her needs. He did not want to make a display of his power, but he wanted to heal and reconcile and give life. Here is what Jesus said to the woman. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. What is that? Daughter, your faith has made you well. He didn't say the power of my garment. He didn't say my power. He said, the power of your faith. He said, your faith has made you well. And then he says, go in peace. This is not like bye-bye. No, no, no. Go in peace. This has a much deeper sense here. And be healed of your disease. This woman has never experienced that peace for 12 years. No peace. Because she wanted to go out. She wanted to do this. But she is under that guilt and that fear from all of these law and these ordinances. And he wanted her to hear physically, emotionally, psychologically, and socially. And he gave her all of that. Thanks be to God. Then we have the impatient disciples in the scene. His disciples said to him in Mark chapter 5, his disciples said to him, you see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say who touched me? You know, in today's language, they probably were saying, are you kidding me, Jesus? Don't you see the crowd around you? Are you kidding me? And you're saying, who touched me? It's like, as are many words that we say when we think that what was said is not smart enough, unfortunately. They may even were blaming the woman because she's interrupting. Remember that happened before one time. Remember, there was a woman, a Gentile woman, who came to Jesus, and she was desperate as well, crying for the healing of her loved one. And Jesus said something which the disciples were saying in their heart. It's not right to take the bread that was supposed to be for the children and give it to the dogs. But this woman, again, wonderful example of desperation, but of humility and love. Master, even the dogs will eat the crumbs that fall from their masters. Humility, humbleness lead to healing, lead to empowerment, lead to fulfilling of our spirit. The disciples' attitude reminds me of a story I read about a suicidal woman. She stood on a bridge in Seattle for 3 hours ready to jump. The situation created such a massive traffic jam that some motorists caught in the delay. They began to curse the woman and screamed at her, "Go ahead and jump!" She did, and she survived the 160-foot fall into a canal. Many residents later sent flowers and cards to her in the hospital, apologizing for what had happened. But some of the angry drivers phoned the local newspaper and blamed the woman for not choosing a less traveled places to end her life. People with urgent needs hardly ever intersect our lives at a convenient times. They always come in non-convenient times. This is what happened to Jesus. He was in his way with this crowd to do something. And it's even very possible that the disciples were wondering when those friends of this man came, "Hey, don't bother the master anymore. Your child is dead." You can imagine what the disciples were looking at Jesus. "You see, we told you, keep going." That tells us about sometimes when it is mostly inconvenient for us that we face. This is actually a lesson for me, because sometimes I want to do something, I want to focus, but then there is interruption. This is a lesson for me, a lesson for all of us, that we will not prevent or we will not hold back if we are asked for help. Brother and sister, are we willing then to reach out to someone in need today, just like the Good Samaritan? You remember what happened? Do you know what's happening here, that Jesus was defiled twice? One time, according to the law and the ordinances, this woman touched him. That's one. And the second time, when he touched that girl that was dead, because according to the law and the ordinances also, you're supposed not to touch corpse. That's why the priests and Levites passed by this poor man and they did not give hands, because they were concerned about their religion. They were concerned about their ordinances. They were concerned about what is supposed to be done and not done. Brother and sister, today another example that tells us that the Sabbath is made for human, not human for the Sabbath. I know this is difficult. I know it was difficult for Jairus. I know it was difficult for those Jewish people who are just can't do. This is a tradition. It's what our parents raised us with. It's what the figure, the father figure, the mother figure, with all what's going on, with their restriction, with their sincerity as well. They're sincere. But the message is a message of grace and love and compassion. There is nothing else. There is nothing else in all of these texts that tells us otherwise. So, brother and sister, have faith, have hope, and continue going and continue trusting, because God doesn't look at the status. God looks at our heart and the trust that we have towards him. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for your message to all of us. We all can belong to one or more of these characters. And I pray, Lord, with all the trust and the love that we have in you, not we have towards you, but in you, we trust that you paid it all. And therefore, we love you and we love our neighbors. Help us to do what is good today and always. In the wonderful name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and let everyone say, Amen. Let us continue our worship and affirm our faith by repeating the Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. So we have again our big list. Pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thy is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Remember, you continue to bless the Lord, and the Lord will continue to bless you for your offering and tithes. Whether we have much or whether we have little, God asks us to offer what we have for God's purpose, including our tithe, our gifts, our skills, and our passions. Let us offer to God what we can, confident that God will take our small offerings and multiply them to abundance for the good of our congregation and our community. And now let us sing the doxology. With me and join me in the printed prayer of dedication. God of all provision, take these gifts and use them for your glory and for the good of our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of dedication is "To God Be the Glory."
Thank you.
people of God go from this place confident, confident in God's promises. Love and serve the Lord. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Just a way of a change. God bless you.